Tonight we're going to talk about reforming, and I had asked you to read chapter 6 in preparation for this talk. I think if you look in there, you see a summary. First of all, the feedstocks, again, as we've talked about, our old friends, paraffins, olefins, naphthenes, and aromatics. In reforming, the name of the game is to either, is to convert all naphthenes to aromatics, certainly not to lose any aromatics that you already have. Olefins are usually low, and before they go to the reformer, are saturated, because olefins tend to make coke in a reformer, in spite of the fact that it's a hydrogenation catalyst and a high-pressure hydrogen. That mechanism is still not well understood today. The name of the game on paraffins is to crack them down to lower molecular weight compounds, which I'll talk about a little bit later, or to isomerize them so they're more highly branched, or to carry out my favorite reaction, which is dehydrocyclization, and which is to convert the paraffin into an aromatic for a real octane gain, unfortunately for a yield loss. So these reactions are summarized here, and they're talked about, and you have a, for those of you who have not had much chemistry, you have examples of all of these. Methyl cyclohexane going to toluene. And another interesting reaction, and I might just put that on the board because I think it's particularly interesting. You see this? Mm-hmm. This is cyclopentane in the center. Put a methyl group here, methyl cyclopentane. Once you have that, you can go to benzene. However, naphthenes, the C5 naphthenes, the C5 ring naphthenes are present, of course, in naphtha up through C9, C10. So there will be other carbon atoms, methyl groups, ethyl groups attached. And the name of the game here is to get isomerization to a six-membered ring. We'll put these two groups here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. We now have isomerized that to a cyclohexane ring, and then good old platinum comes along and dehydrogenates it, and not only gives us an aromatic, but it gives us 3 moles of hydrogen. And which hydrogen is very valuable in then further treating, removing sulfur, nitrogen, oxygen, saturating olefinic bonds, saturating polynuclear aromatics, as we talked about. As you recall, and we'll talk about this in much more detail, and the paper I handed out, it's an old one, but I think we covered just about all the reaction mechanisms, and I'll discuss that in more detail, but it is to make, say, a normal heptane and isomerize it into more highly branched compounds, and these all have very high octane numbers. You get a little expansion in this case. The normal paraffin packs a little better than the branched molecules, so you get a little expansion in that case. Now also, we can cut this in half. As you recall, normal heptane is the standard for 0 octane number. And if we clip off here, we get a higher octane normal paraffin. So just reducing the molecular weight is, in its own right, a way of increasing the octane number. Now, the interesting thing about the platinum reforming catalyst, it was the first catalyst which, due to intensive study, resulted in the discovery of the dual site mechanism. And it's a very important mechanism in catalysis because it develops a relationship between those two active sites. The people at Hoodry many years ago, Alex Oblad, Alex Mills, who's now in government with DOE, and I believe he's giving a paper on catalysis at the ACS meeting in Atlanta next week or 2 weeks from now. And the idea is that the molecule, as we've talked about, comes in to the catalyst surface where there's a platinum site present. It gives up hydrogen and comes off as an olefin. The olefin then comes over to an acidic site, sits down, is isomerized into our old friend, the tertiary carbonium ion, comes off again, isomerized, still an olefin, although it may transfer by the carbonium ion mechanism, it may also transfer here without going through the site once that olefin is established. It then comes back to our old friend platinum, is saturated and comes off as isopentane. Now, to prove this mechanism, catalysts were made which had no acidity but had platinum on it, and had acidity but no platinum on it. And what they did is they took this material and ground it up. And they ground it up, first of all, in large pieces and put them together. Then they gradually made them smaller and smaller until a platinum site and a carbonium ion site were closer together. And as they did this, the reaction mechanism sped up, the conversion sped up. I think it's been fairly well established that this is a dual site mechanism, and it's an intriguing one. It's the first time that such a mechanism was suspected, studied, and fairly well proven. So platinum on alumina, I think, holds a charm beyond the fact that it is an interesting catalyst. I couldn't decide where to begin and where to end tonight. I suppose one could talk for hours and hours on platinum, on alumina reforming, because there was so much work done by so many people, and so many people who are famous today in catalytic circles first acquired that fame in platinum reforming. I think, again, I'll just remind you of its history, for those of you who weren't here. The first really good platinum on alumina, the first people who had the courage to do such a silly thing as try to put a precious metal on a support and use it in petroleum processing, was Universal Oil Products, who developed this process and catalyst about 1947 through 1949, introduced it to the world in 1949, and the automotive industry was waiting for high-octane gasoline so they could pep up their cars, and so it was a beautiful marriage. Now there was a tool that could produce high-octane gasoline, and here was a market just waiting for it. So the two of them came in together, and there was a tremendous battle for high compression engines and high octane gasolines. And we in the petroleum industry were fighting hard to make higher and higher octane gasoline, and the automotive industry was working hard to increase their compression ratios. It was indeed an exciting time, and predictions of a 100-octane number and so forth were made, and at one point in about 1957, 100-octane number gasoline was being produced. But it was a terrible shrinkage of feedstock, and so it was costly. Of course, it was only costly for $3 a barrel then, as against $35, $40 a barrel today. And about that time, Frank Ciappetta, who had stumbled on this dual site without realizing what he had stumbled upon, produced a similar catalyst, a platinum on silica alumina, in which he had steamed the silica alumina down, and which he had arranged to marry the rate of dehydrogenation with the rate of acidity or cracking. And I might add that this is just the opposite of what we're trying to do with our RCC process today. We're trying to separate the two. The metals on the catalyst are dehydrogenation catalysts similar to the platinum. The acidity or the zeolite is the cracking catalyst. And now we don't want that dehydrogenation activity. We want only that cracking activity. Well, the metal is piling up, so we have to race ahead. And what do? To race ahead, we try to build an acidity in that catalyst that is so much greater than the acidity of the, or than the dehydrogenation activity, that again, we're in a safe area. And that is no mean trick to do, and we are heavily involved in that challenge at the present time. At the same time that UOP said there will be a platinum reforming process, a guy by the name of Murphy, who was president of Exxon Development Company, said there will be a fluid moly process. And Exxon devoted tremendous effort to making a molybdena on alumina fluid process. It was not unlike the fluid cracking process in many ways, and we've talked about it. The only problem was that the catalyst wasn't too active, and so you had to use a homogeneous bed, and therefore you had the back mixing that we talked about, and over cracking and under cracking, and so it was hard to get a high octane number with a fluid moly. I believe there's only one unit in the world still running, and I believe it's in Venezuela, where, by the way, it has a better chance of operating because the naphtha is a highly naphthenic naphtha, and therefore you can get a high conversion to aromatics. You don't have to do this trick of dehydrocyclization. I'll show you after a while that moly is not nearly as good on dehydrocyclization, and that's the name of the game, really. At that time, the man we were working for at Sinclair, who I mentioned to you, John Teeter decided to develop a platinum reforming catalyst in coordination and cooperation with the old Baker Company, which is now part of Engelhardt Minerals and Chemicals. And Sinclair is now part of ARCO, so this team doesn't exist anymore. But they came up with a new catalyst, and I was really fortunate to be around at that time with this development. It was quite an exciting development in its own right. A lot of high-powered scientists worked on this. And they introduced the concept of a small particle in a fixed bed, which was revolutionary. As I told you, no one made anything used anything other than a pellet or a bead. Well, good old Exxon began to give up on fluid reforming, and they also were aware of the advantage of a small pellet or a small particle, but they were afraid to use anything but a tablet. And so they developed the catalyst in a very thin tablet form. And as I mentioned previously, the problem with this one was it was so expensive to tablet that it was no longer commercially acceptable. I believe Exxon does still have a catalyst of their own, but it was not this one. And finally, UOP had been making a bead, and for years they dreamed of a continuous reforming process, not unlike the fluid reforming process. And they ultimately, although I understand it was again one of those things where the innovator has to fight very hard to get his idea introduced. Now it's a big business with UOP, And the catalyst is a bead catalyst, but it's a lot finer, and it flows somewhat like the fluid catalyst. And it's a tough catalyst. We don't think it's too active or too selective, but under the conditions of 100 to 150 pounds pressure, the poor selectivity is made up for by the low pressure severity, which is in a thermodynamically favorable region for dehydrocyclization and dehydrogenation. Was a lot of work went into these. The platinum crystallite size, regeneration in which you burn the carbon off. We found that this supposedly precious metal, inert metal, did oxidize, and as platinum oxide would skate around the surface, under reducing conditions, the metal atoms would come back together and form big crystallites. And so a technique was devised for using high-pressure oxygen to help disperse the platinum. And if you start out with a surface that's highly rough, and you put these platinum atoms in here, they stay fairly well dispersed in a good surface area. As time goes by, this surface starts to sinter out, and these platinum atoms begin to migrate. And when you regenerate, you burn the carbon off, you activate it again, but they're still together. And then you can take a high-pressure oxygen and disperse them, and again the platinum atoms will redisperse. But the alumina surface is sintering all this time, and so this tends to come back together and becomes more and more difficult to disperse with time. So there is a finite number of times you can regenerate these catalysts. We'll speak of the bimetallics a little bit. Rhenium, platinum, and iridium, and you'll see some of the work we did that led to some of this work, really. These are alloys or combinations. In the case of rhenium, the rhenium tends to spread out and stabilize this so that when you work, and also I believe put hydrogen on the surface so that coking reactions occur a lot more slowly and the catalyst has a much longer life. But these were discovered much later, almost 15 years later after the original catalysts were developed. The understanding of the possibility of using bimetallics or more was well understood. In the early 50s already, we were working on that concept, the idea that you could change the behavior of the D-band electrons by changing the alloy composition. We knew that a platinum liked to take hydrogen off and other metals, and some hung on to a little more and a little less, and you reasoned that if you could find the right combination, you would hold on to the hydrocarbons and the hydrogen just the right amount, and thereby have the ideal catalyst, and this eventually was did result. Well, I can't tell you how many aluminas were discovered, how many people worked on this program, many great tools, and I did outline for you the many developments that resulted from it. Many have called it the golden era of catalysis, but I think the sieve era may be a second golden era of catalysis. I don't think they were anticipating molecular sieves coming along, because it has provided another great incentive to understand and the development of tools that can be used to study catalysis. I'd like to just remind you now of the commercial units before I get into a more detailed picture of reforming and give you some insight into the effect of various inhibitors on these reactions. For those of you who have your booklets, if you give me those, the builders or whoever's back there, there's about five slides with a metallic luster to them that are white, I guess they're white, which have those, for those who haven't brought their books. I see I forgot my pointer today.
Yeah, sun's moving.
Okay. Everyone see that this is, can you back that off one? I think what is it down here? Yes, again, this was the magniforming process by Engelhardt, Division of Engelhardt Minerals and Chemicals, with the RD150 catalyst in it. Long-lived catalyst can operate at about 300 pounds pressure. And the idea here was that you got, in the first step, you usually dehydrogenate your naphthenes, so you get a fast temperature drop. You pick the temperature back up again because this is a highly endothermic reaction. You complete your dehydrogenation reactions and some of your isomerization of naphthenes to cyclohexane naphthenes, dehydrogenation. But now you've completed most of that, and now you're ready for your catalytic cracking and your isomerization and dehydrocyclization. Some of the hydrogen that's produced is recycled back through here because most of your aging occurs in these two vessels here. They're up at higher temperature, both of them, and the higher temperature, the more rapidly coke formation occurs. So they also recycle more hydrogen to keep the hydrogen partial pressure as high as possible, especially in this cracking sequence. And then it's the prog is taken off and stabilized. And while that looks rather simple, it is a rather complex series of steps, and Engelhardt was able to patent that and does receive a royalty. This is the, almost says it doesn't talk about it. Has anyone heard what happened to our stock today? Anyone know? Huh?
It dropped 1 7/8 from yesterday.
Well, the rumor was, I guess, it was Alpha-Octane that was interested, which is a French firm. And this is a catalytic reforming process of the Institute, French Institute of Petroleum Research, closely related to that because Alpha-Octane is partially a government. There's too many wires here. One of the features of the French process was the recycling of catalysts, which is closely related to UOP's continuous regeneration reforming. And the Hoodry process, which again is a modification very similar to the Engelhardt magniforming process. And then the continuous regeneration reformer of UOP. And of course, you recall we have one out here. The catalyst, regenerate catalyst is brought up to the top. By the way, I wonder, Bill, if someone could go get me that pointer. Maybe. I hate to do that, but I guess I... We're having a sunbeam coming through there. Guess we can't do anything about it, can we?
Go ahead and swap it, bro.
Huh?
Put you on the other side of the screen here.
Yeah. Anyhow, this is the regenerate catalyst brought to the top, dropped through. This is that little reactor where a lot of dehydrogenation occurs, but it's a very fast reaction. The reactor temperature drops. Heated back up, brought back in, taken out, and brought back in one more time for the final reaction. Very similar to the others, except the catalyst is continually flowing. Power forming, which is a swing reactor system. As you recall, it allows one reactor to be down, regenerating, while the others are operating. Brenner forming, which is a chevron process, which can operate at much lower processing conditions because of the longer life achieved with the rhenium bimetallic catalyst. And finally, the ultraforming process of Standard of Indiana. Again, they were the first ones to pioneer the idea of regeneration, and they early recognized the value of low pressure reforming, and we'll talk about that in a few minutes now. So, I think now what I'd like to have you do is take this paper. From what I could see of the slides, it's going to be hard for you to read it. In order to study the reforming reactions and understand them, I was fortunate to be given the opportunity to start utilizing my own reactor at an early age in my career. We didn't have any assistance at that time. We did all the work, charged our catalyst in the morning, made the run, collected the product, and stabilized product while the next one was started the next morning, and wrote my reports at night. And I was fortunate enough to have John Teeter, who was a brilliant catalytic chemist, started me out on reactors, and a guy by the name of Bob Elkins, who is now with the Gas Institute in Chicago. Bob was interested in reaction mechanisms, and it was just at the time that the Hoodby people had published their work on methylcyclopentane. And I asked if they'd mind if I worked on normal heptane, because I thought it'd be an ideal molecule to study all the reforming reactions. And being a physical chemist, I was interested in the rates of reactions, and we have one rate to isomerization. And we have another reaction here that can go to cracking. And this can also cyclize, in other words, this can bite itself by the tail, and it can either go to the methyl cyclopentane derivative or cyclopentane derivative, or it can go to C6 naphthene, and then to toluene. This can in turn isomerize two cyclohexane derivatives, thank you, Bill, and also go to toluene. Now, first thing I asked myself was, if I isomerize these molecules to equilibrium, and if I reduce the molecular weight, what's going to happen to the octane number? So let me have this series of slides. I'll see if how they turn out. It's the Bill. It's ahead of the zero about six slides. Yeah. Let's move it all the way back, maybe. Can you lower that just a little bit? Well, let's see if it's all right. As Paul Sabatier, the Frenchman who also worked with precious metals, and you would call Val Hensel, who was here for one of our kickoff meetings, Tri-State Catalyst Club, the won the President's Medal, Science Medal for his work in platinum. And our old friend Frank Ciappetta, who is the person who's being honored again at the Ciappetta Lectureship in Lexington a week from next Monday. And I hope all of you will be there. We're having our Tri-State Catalyst Club meeting at the Horse Farm, and this will be in honor of Dr. Ciappetta, who is the other inventor of platinum reforming catalysts. Now, if you take and isomerize any of these molecules, butane, pentane, hexane, heptane, octane, isomerize them to equilibrium. as determined by thermodynamics, and those numbers are all available. This is the kind of octane number you get. So you can see that if I were to rely on isomerization alone with normal heptane, I could only get up to about 60 octane number. So we proposed to study the reaction of normal heptane under many different conditions. And this is a typical reactor setup. A hydrocarbon feed with a pump and a dryer, very important, down through a two-way valve with hydrogen coming in to join it through a deoxo unit, dryer, purge. That little valve there and that setup is something I'm very proud of, and it took a long time to understand. But it's a very critical step in reforming studies, because if you're studying a new catalyst, the first thing you have to do is reduce it in hydrogen at atmospheric pressure. Now, what happens so many times with the inexperienced researcher, he'll put his catalyst in here, he will have just run with a hydrocarbon the day before, and he doesn't have this kind of a valve system. So what happens is he has hydrocarbon in the line. He brings in hydrogen at atmospheric pressure over the catalyst, and while he's doing that, he's passing hydrocarbon over the catalyst, a small amount, and so frequently the catalyst was deactivated before it ever got on stream. By having this rundown system and a bleed system through that same valve, we purge the lines and the valve of any hydrocarbon when this run is completed, and by the time we're ready for the next run, the line is clean. Now that seems like a small detail, and yet I can assure you many catalysts that were probably good were lost because of a simple misunderstanding of how sensitive a platinum catalyst is at atmospheric pressure at high temperature. Catalyst is located in this bed with thermocouples in the center. The hydrocarbon comes in, comes through a spiral preheat zone, is heated up to temperature, passes through the bed, and is passed through a liquid collection system. The hydrogen is metered and passes through the same in the usual rate, maybe 3 to 4 moles of 5 moles of hydrogen per mole of hydrocarbon. So that's kind of apparatus we used, feeding normal heptane here, passing it through. As I began working with, at that time everything was reforming was operated at 500 pounds pressure, and practically no dehydrocyclization occurs at that temperature. I became curious about the possibility, being a physical chemist, I immediately thought, boy, if I drop the temperature and pressure, I'm going to get something else, perhaps. And there had been a slight indication that it was possible to get dehydrocyclization at lower pressure, but at that time no one was talking about it. So I went to the literature and made a study of the thermodynamic equilibrium. What it said is that when I got down to 100 pounds, even at 800 degrees, I was the thermodynamic equilibrium for converting normal heptane to toluene was very good. So I began to move down in pressure. And by the way, this was the kinetics that I worked out. The rate of disappearance of normal heptane is equal to these three rate constants, where one is the hydrocracking, one to isomerization, and one to cyclization. Cyclization then was an isomerization step to a cyclohexane, or I could go directly there, and finally dehydrogenation to toluene. So I began to work on pressure and temperature, and the first work was simply the disappearance of normal heptane. And if you look at the disappearance of normal heptane, it's not too sensitive to pressure. In fact, the reaction rate is a little slower at 200 pounds than at 500 pounds. Now, these slides are not very good, and you may want to look in your handbook or your handout. What I wanted to show you here was, this is something that I guess maybe some of the young scientists, when I started talking about these things, and when I push our mass spectrometer people and so forth. And I say I want a better analysis. We did not have much gas chromatography at that time, although it was being used. Someone want to come in and give a talk? We were able at that time to break these down into all the isomers, which I think in 1951 or 52, a lot of people would think that that wasn't possible. But we already, at Sinclair, to show you how far behind the times we are here, Sinclair already had a scanning and a transmission electron microscope at that time. And they also had an X-ray diffraction instrument of the highest quality. Bob Van Nordstrand, who's still famous in catalysis, was operating that time, and John Brown was running the electron microscope. Mark Johnson, in 1951, who's still operating, was running surface area, pore volume, pore diameter distribution. It was a remarkable team. And I was fortunate that they let me work on pure hydrocarbon mechanisms. So you see, we could follow this very closely at that time already. And by the way, these are the experimental mole percents, and these are the theoretical. So we are closely related, except you do not get neopentane. Well, I immediately began to look for aromatics, and to my surprise, but pleasure really, found that when going to 200 pounds, we were making a considerable amount of aromatics, and this at that time was quite a surprise, I think, certainly to my boss, John Teeter, and to me too. And we showed the sensitivity of it. So the disappearance of normal heptane was occurring at the same rate, but the product distribution was quite different. So if we take at the 2 weight-hourly space velocity, 5 hydrocarbon to 1 mole of hydrocarbon, hydrogen to hydrocarbon, and plot the aromatic content, you can see how sensitive it is to pressure. Now, I want to present these to you in this manner because I think the way to understand reforming is to understand these driving forces. And once you understand this fundamental stuff, commercial operation is duck soup, really. Then, in order to get more information on the kinetics and plotting it versus 1 over space velocity, you can see that the disappearance here, and in fact, we can use these disappearance in this area to get a basic reaction rate. This is a conversion of C7 isomers. You see it goes through a maximum. You get up here to a lot of them, and then because of our story on carbonium ion cracking, remember the tertiary carbon and so forth, you get a lot more cracking, and so this disappears. So in terms of optimum isomerization activity, you want to run at a fairly high space velocity. Now if you plot these conversions to all these products, what you get is isomerization peaking, but dehydrocyclization and hydrocracking rising. So in this case, at 200 pounds, the isomerized material is also being dehydrocyclized, which I think is an interesting thing to speculate on. And it doesn't seem to work if you start with a highly branched paraffin, but it does work under these conditions. Well, this is too hard to see, I think. It simply shows that we at various space velocities. Oh, no, I'm sorry. One of the questions I asked was, how fast does methylcyclohexane dehydrogenate? And it was obvious that as soon as you got a naphthene, you had almost immediately an aromatic. And so we ran dehydrogenation as a function of pressure. And I believe what we found at that time was that it was essentially constant, that dehydrogenation was not too sensitive. Then we also decided to compare the rate of conversion of cyclohexane, methylcyclohexane, and ethylcyclohexane. And what we found was that cyclohexane was slow, but when you got to methylcyclohexane, it was a lot faster. Ethyl cyclohexane, I think, present a little steric hindrance, so it was down a little bit. And the question was, what happens to the cyclopentanes? And I was fortunate to obtain a high cyclopentane feedstock from one of our refineries in California. You can see it has about 60% cyclopentyl material in it. And by studying this as a function of space velocity, we were also able to show that it was rapidly converted at 200 pounds into aromatics at a very high space velocity. This is an 18 to 37 space velocity. We already had a 31% conversion, and the aromatics were 15 volume percent of the total. So from this information, we were able to determine the rate constants at various pressures. For example, these first three are 925. The total disappearance of normal heptane is not too sensitive to pressure, 500, 350, 200. Hydrocracking is. You see, the rate of hydrocracking is twice as great at 500 as at 200. Isomers, we increase the molecular weight. Obviously, if you can tie a little normal heptane into a loop, you ought to be able to do a lot better job with normal no-name, because you have a lot of extra carbon atoms, one of which can come back and double on another one. And so we ran normal no-name, and we found that, in fact, the aromatics weight percent of feed went from 40% to 60%, and even at a higher space velocity. And so, if you want to convert wax to aromatics, it's no trick over a platinum catalyst. As a matter of fact, we're using this little trick today in our jet fuel work. What about octane number? I've plotted here both research octane number, and some of you may or may not be familiar with performance number. It's a different way of rating. I always like performance number because it has a linear relationship with a performance, whereas, octane number is a very misleading kind of thing. As Mike will tell you, you can tell a lot there's between a 94 and a 92 octane number, but it's only two little units apart. Whereas with a performance number, you see you get that from 90 to 92, you've got a 5-degree increment here from 95 to 97, or from 93 to 97, you get a 10. In other words, it's spaced out at this on this end. And so if we plot either versus octane number or performance number, at 100 pounds, you see you get, there's no points on this curve. I think there should be a point that I don't see it. Let's take 200 pounds. At 200 pounds, 95 octane number, you get almost 60 volume percent from normal heptane, whereas at 500 pounds, you can't even get there. You're way down here about 10%. 350, you're about 40%. This is the kind of thing that pays off at that time. Today, this reaction also pays off in terms of the use of aromatics, the petrochemical industry. But you can see what a difference the pressure makes. And this is why our little continuous reformer down here at 150 pounds is, people say, oh man, it's doing great. And it is doing great. But, if you're used to running at 350 to 500 pounds and you suddenly are running at 150 pounds, anything looks great. And therefore, you have to be a little careful, because there's a tendency to say, gee, that's great, when maybe, in fact, you can squeeze another 3 to 5% out of that if your catalyst is really good. And someday, we want to put our stethoscope on that UOP catalyst when we have time and see what can be done to make a better catalyst. Now, the thing that really began to come to the forefront, we were making some 1/16. It was the first time anyone had made 1/16. It was John Teeter's idea, along with Carl Keith, who's now president of Engelhardt Division. And I got a hold of some of that, and I ran, and lo and behold, I found that the selectivity was also dependent on particle size, and that was quite an interesting discovery, because up to that time, we thought that particle size only influenced life and not yield, and especially its impact at lower pressures here. At high pressures, it wouldn't be so critical because we would be hydrocracking. But here, you see the yield of toluene was considerably increased. Well, then we said, I wonder what happens with particle size on dehydrogenation. And again, we ran with 1/8, 1/16, and 20 to 28 mesh, and you can see the tremendous impact that particle size has on dehydrogenation. Again, it all points to the desirability of a small catalyst. Well, I spent a lot of time reading the literature, and Harrington and Radil in England had done a lot of work on dehydrocyclization with chromium catalysts prior to World War II. And I also got the catalyst boys to make me iridium, rhodium, palladium, and a moly, which was then the popular reforming catalyst for Exxon, and a chromia catalyst, which was made along the lines of the early work of Radil. And we ran them all, and you can see that even though this was touted as a great dehydrocyclization catalyst, it in no way compared with platinum. They just weren't in the same ballpark. And of course, that got me pretty excited, and that was the beginning to pressure our company into starting to design at lower pressures. But then, as today, the engineers are always cautious, and I can recall the many arguments I had with Barlow Smith, who said an engineer can only go where the path has been laid out, and we can't deviate. We know that we will be able to run at 500 pounds, but we don't know what will happen at 200 pounds. And so we said, well, to hell with you. We'll give a paper and let somebody else exploit this thing. You know, engineers sometimes have to be very cautious, because if the thing fails, it's their neck. So they build themselves a lot of safeguards into a process, and they're still doing it today. And it's unfortunate. But I suppose if we were responsible for the design and that baby was going to cost $70 or $80 million, we'd be pretty cautious too. But nevertheless, it was not Sinclair that picked this work up, but Standard of Indiana that picked it up and began to exploit it. Well, I just want to give you some feel for some of the other things that we learned. This is some data for the particle size, and this is the dehydrogenation reaction, which you can see there. This is the effect of platinum concentration. We had to make catalysts 3/10, 6/10, and 1%, and found that in terms of conversion, at 200 pounds, that we approached the maximum at about 6/10. And today, I believe the catalysts are mainly 3,500s or less, but the early catalysts were all 6/10. That was a good number both for life as well as for activity and selectivity. Again, the same thing on running with on dehydrocyclization. You can see at about 3,500s already, we were close to a maximum. By 6/10 platinum, we were at a good point. This is the data on the various catalysts other than platinum. I think it's interesting that we were trying iridium and rhodium and so forth in the 1951-52 when, and I think we were fortunate to do that because we were working with Baker, who was a prime marketer of precious metals in the United States. They had these precious metals. Unfortunately, they didn't have rhenium, and every time I asked for rhenium, and I put in a request why the price was so high for a gram or two that I would be turned down. And I don't blame them for doing that. This was where we began to determine the effect of water. Water competing for the acidic sites, water stripping off halide. The catalyst base we had was considered acidic enough that it didn't need the halide. And there was a big argument going on in the patent literature and in the literature as to whether you need the halide or not for acidity. Today it's concluded that you need acidity, but I think it's because the alumina has a lot less acidity of its own. We had here the acidity from the randomite, from gibbsite and barite, which gave it a degree of acidity of its own right. And also these catalysts were not built for regeneration after regeneration after regeneration. So you can read in there the effect of water. Water did tend to depress the reactions. It saturated the acidic sites, I believe. When we ran with water on methylcyclohexane, we really didn't affect the dehydrogenation reaction too much. Then we got the sulfur. Sulfur at that time was suspected of being a bad actor, but no one knew what sulfur really would do and how it would affect the mechanism, so we proposed to study that. Here's one where we put a little sulfur in. You can see our C5 plus is down. The aromatic yield is way down. The octane number isn't too bad. Turns out that the sulfur can give you a degree of acidity, which to a certain extent makes up for it, although it makes up for it by isomerization and cracking. So what happens when we put sulfur in methylcyclohexane? Well, that's an altogether different story. It really poisoned the platinum catalyst. You can see here, putting as little as, this is a pretty big slug, 5% sulfur, is thiophene, knocked the activity down from 61% conversion to 5. At 200 pounds, the same thing. By putting just a little bit of sulfur in as isopropyl mercaptan, 0.16%, we knocked it down from 80 to 50. Conclusion, sulfur is bad, keep it out, and this is what started the interest in hydrotreating feed to a reformer. And it's been practiced ever since. Okay, what about nitrogens? Nitrogens are present in some feedstocks, fairly good amount, and we certainly know in shale oils and H coal that we're dealing with a lot of nitrogen. Nitrogen being a known as a poison for acidic sites, conclusion, it ought to be tough on a catalyst too, a reforming catalyst. And we put a little bit of nitrogen in, 0.046 is ammonia. Sure enough, conversion to aromatics down from 37 to 16, octane number from 95 to 52. Let's try nonane, a little bigger molecule, see what happens there. Same thing, 99 octane number, 59 octane number. Conversion, 63 down to 24. Conclusion, keep nitrogen out of the feedstock. And today, that feedstock is so carefully prepared that there's less than 1/10 of part per million of sulfur, 1/10 per million of oxygen or nitrogen. And it's run with a very fine adjustment. You add a little bit of water and a little bit of halide, and you keep these other ingredients out, contaminants out. What happens, on the other hand, to methylcyclohexane? There the platinum should be untouched. We don't need isomerization, all we need is dehydrogenation. Put the ammonia in, the nitrogen in, sure enough, no effect. Conclusion, again, dual site mechanism. Platinum okay, acidic site no good. Okay, about that time a reactor went down and we pulled it apart and we found we had arsenic in it. My boss said, hey, why don't you run some arsenic over the catalyst? I said, whoa, I sure want to do that. And he said, oh, yeah, well, you know, go ahead and do it. I said, okay. So we got some triphenyl RC. And I still remember closing the doors, and I put on a gas mask and a pack. I put my triphenyl RC in the normal heptane, put it in, and ran it. And at this point, it was 200 parts per billion. And what we found is that even then we were beginning to get some lack of conversion. And then when I put in a big slug of it, now we're beginning to put quite a bit on the catalyst. You know, at first it was just hitting the top and absorbing. Now it was beginning to penetrate the catalyst, and you can see that the yield is coming down. The conversion to aromatics In this case, I don't know what happened here. I guess the yield was down, so in fact, the concentration was up. No, it was... I'll have to understand that. I think this line here... Anyhow, we went to methylcyclohexane, and with the same experiment, with just a little bit of arsenic in, we knocked it down, and with a lot of arsenic in there, and there we actually put the arsenic on, so we would be sure we had it on. You can see dehydrogenation is way down. There was some problem of getting arsenic throughout the whole catalyst system, and if you don't get it through the whole catalyst system, you sometimes miss the point of it, in this case, because it does absorb. Well, there's a lot that can be said about the commercial aspects of reforming, the economics, how it fits in with other processes. I had a whole series of slides showing the octane numbers, how they're blended with other operations, alkylation, isomerization, cap cracking. But today, with the lead being removed, the reform is a real workhorse. And unfortunately, as we've talked about before, it is a barrel shrinker. So it's a costly thing to operate. And it's one reason why, why it's so costly to make your high octane components. And I think you can see from the change in yield as you come off of that high octane number, how difficult it is to get up to 90, 95, and 98 octane number with reforming, because you are rapidly losing yield. Fortunately, some of it's going into isobutane, but that's about all. There's no isobutylene, no propylene as we get in catalytic cracking to make up for it. There is lots of hydrogen, and as you go down in pressure, which I didn't show you here, but as you go down in pressure, of course, your volume of hydrogen production goes way up. And that hydrogen then is so great that you can use it for all kinds of hydrotreating around the refinery. And you can put it back into your cat-cracking feedstock. You can put it into your heating oils, your cycle oils, put it back in. And for that reason, you know, we have a lot of hydrotreaters out in our refinery there, and they're all dependent on the reformer. That concludes.